Hello, Malty Multiverses. I'm Ralphie. This is Ralphy Review 661. And thank you to Alec Caton for the malt mention. It's not a malt we're reviewing, though, although we do have a malt mention because it is necessary to get things going, to get things flowing in terms of the monologue, the presentation, the description, the smelling, the tasting, the rye mark, because it's not going to be a malt mark. Oh, no, no, no. This is Rittenhouse straight rye bottled in bond. So we are taking a visit to the US of A and exploring an American spirit, specifically American, because nowhere else in the world will you find the whole bottled in bond phenomenon. Only America. And I find it remarkable that highly financed marketing departments do not make more of this unique historical provenance specification that enhances the reputation of a spirit. What's it all about? It's about the Bottled and Bond Act of 1897. It's about the fact that in the 19th century in the US, as in with most other countries around the world, there was a problem. And the problem was that the distillers were producing and selling liquor to the bars, to the speakeasies, to the little corner shops, to the drugstores, yes, for turning into elixirs and tonics for people with a nervous disposition. We can relate to that at times. And unfortunately, a lot of the liquor was being adulterated. The colour was being adulterated with the likes of iodine and tobacco and tannins and brown polish, boot polish, to name a few. The flavour was being adulterated with fruit syrups, if you were lucky, with sulfuric acid, with anything and everything that could be added to dilute the spirit and still make it passable to people who were possibly aware of what a decent spirit tasted like. But you see, the rub is, malt mates, it's all very well when you're sober, but after you've had a few drinks, that's when the bar staff would bring out the fire water, the adulterated liquor, and start serving it. And of course, when people are pished, they no longer have articulate senses of smell and taste. Don't we know all about that? Rest assured, malt mates, I'm stone cold, clean sober for this, because it's necessary to set a good example and also to really enjoy the unique character of this particular rye. Ryes are becoming more popular. They're becoming more recognised as quality spirits in their own right. And it's exciting to see that there's now a standard of rye being made, which we really haven't seen before. And importantly, there's more varieties. Rye used to be left mainly to the Canadians with their style of rye whiskey production. For the global market, American ryes tended to be really for the domestic market in nostalgia bars and for old guys to enjoy the days gone by, you know, with a whiskey and rye, days gone by with a whiskey and rye. I'll introduce you to a whiskey and rye very shortly. But before that, I'm just going to remind you what bottled in bond means, because it was a piece of administrative law brought in by government to address the adulteration issue. And what they did was they created a law that if the bottle stated bottled in bond, the buyer could be assured that what they were buying had not been adulterated in the bottling plant or beyond and resealed. So what do you need for bottled and bond? Well, it needs to be a spirit produced in one distillery season, which roughly runs for 6 months. You've got the spring-summer season, you've got the autumn-winter season. Also, you've got to have one distiller in one distillery producing the liquor. It has then got to go into a government-supervised bonded warehouse, in which in the old days you literally had excise officers standing at the door with guns. It's true. And it must be aged in the warehouse for a minimum of 4 years old. So when you see a bottled in bond liquor from the United States, the youngest age is 4 years. It may be older. Worth noting that. Finally, it must be bottled at 100 proof American, which is 50% alcohol. So here we have Rittenhouse, good brand, good name, make good rye, with their bottled and bond rye. If you see a bottle of this, malt mates, I highly recommend that you buy a bottle and you try it out, because it's a really nice, earthy, mineral, non-confectionery rye. See, there's a lot of varieties of rye out there. You can make a hard rye spirit, a soft rye spirit, a fruity rye spirit, a floral rye spirit. This particular rye spirit happens to be earthy and quite robust, even after its minimum 4 years maturation. And I'll tell you what, malt mates, makes it all the better. Where's my spoon? It's at 50%. I'm going to add water, but half a teaspoon will do. I'm not adding much. And next, smell and taste. Rye is quite unmistakable. It's when you taste and smell rye on its own, you really start to spot it in rye-dominated bourbons, and just how it mingles and accentuates the other grains within the bourbon spirit, which of course is made from a mixed mash bill. There is that floral note, but it's quite sweet and toffied. It's not too violety. It's a lovely high-end strawberry toffee note. Something camphorish. Yeah, that's what it is, camphorish. A little bit of naphthalene, as in mothballs, and the most wonderful sort of resinous minty note. Apple mint, a little bit of pineapple, scorched pan-fried pineapple. As it settles down and opens up, those mint and slightly phenolic vegetal features get amplified, and it really benefits from that change in direction. Really as a result of the fact that it's still relatively young as a rye, but it's got sufficient maturation that it's really kind of rounding off the harsher notes that you do tend to get when it's quite a rapidly distilled and youngish spirit. Rye, malt mates, can be rough. This isn't rough. It's that beautiful balance. It's robust without being rough. On the taste, sweet and sour. The sour turns bitter. Licorice, aniseed, camphor again. Mint in the development, beautiful mint, slight violet note, vanilla and lime leaf, and pickled pineapple as you're going into the finish. The finish is not terribly long as an experience, but you'll find that with ryes. You'll also find that when ryes are aged for too long in active casks, that it tends to be the oak from the cask which really starts to assert itself, and therefore older ryes are not necessarily better ryes. Far from it, in fact. Another wee taste. Refreshingly, a non-sweet rye. is quite astringent, quite biting, but it's never hurts when it bites. Do you know what I mean? It's not a hot spirit. It's just honest, refreshing, quite earthy, mineral. So rather than too much sweetness, or there's a hint of sweetness at the beginning, it's the sourness and the bitterness which is dominating the development into the finish, and it's producing quite a fantastic result. There you go, now you know. And it says in the back of the label, wonderful news, we've got some clarity. Yes, we've got some product transparency. Now that helps. Distilled and bottled by Heaven Hill Distilleries. It wasn't distilled for them. It wasn't distilled somewhere else and then sent down to them for them to put their name on it. No. It says in the label, distilled and bottled by Heaven Hill Distilleries. Here we go. Lovely stuff. I suspect the way things are going, as Pappy's become way too expensive and increasingly not good value for money, that collectors and aficionados will have take a renewed interest in bottled in bond spirits, and it will bring significant recognition and rather good publicity to those American distillers who actually not just produce the stuff but promote it as well. Rye mark. Quite getting that resinous. Is becoming increasingly cola infused. Rye mark, 87 out of 100. Interestingly, this is the first bottled and bond rye that I've come across. And interestingly, it's become a bit of a benchmark with which to compare other ryes. And something that's really jumped out at me with this particular bottled and bond version is it comes across as non-engineered and an honest old-fashioned rye, where the flavour is not, there's no attempt to sanitise or diminish the flavour to make it more palatable to modern palates. It is robust. It's the way it should be. Big, bold. There's not huge development and complexities in the finishes you would get with some bourbons and single malts. It's not about that. That's not the event. It's the wonderful transparency of the experience and the provenance of the authentic historical provenance of an appellation bottled in bond. It was never about marketing initiatives. It was all about addressing practicalities and problems affecting distillers in the old days and the practical ways they went about finding a solution to these problems with the support of the government, who, of course, were all about the taxes they could raise. It's the way it goes. Now, did I mention a whiskey and rye? Whiskey and rye is a fine old tradition. When, in the old days, spirits were young, they weren't hanging about in casks for very long because there wasn't a demand, people didn't have the money to pay for more expensive stuff, and also there were losses from the cask. Therefore, your rye tended to be quite strong and astringent, and what they did was that they would, in the bars, to make the, at times, sanitised neutral whiskey a bit more flavoursome, they would half and half it with the rye. So here we have a bottle of Eagle Rare, as recommended by a number of you malt mates that I should go and look out for, and which I will be reviewing next. Don't want to give too much away. And I will take this rather nice Kentucky Straight bourbon whiskey and I will add a splash to this Rittenhouse Bottled and Bond Dry. Now, I'm sure you bourbon fans will agree, this looks like a combination made in heaven, does it not? Well, the proof is in the smelling and the tasting. I know I haven't given it very long, but here goes. If in doubt, try it for yourself. The resinous tone, the stridency and the scorched toffee notes of the rye, the mintiness as well has significantly subsided, but you're still getting that distinctive rye note on the nose. The rather luscious, well-matured and rounded Kentucky Straight bourbon from this Eagle Rare 10-year-old is really complementing the rye beautifully and has the substance of character to assert itself with the rye quite successfully, considering that I've more or less added half and half. To put it briefly, the flavour gives older versions of Pappy Van Winkle a real run for their money. This is the sensible punter's quality American whiskey and rye mixer moment. No ice cubes? Nah. A drop of water? That's quite enough. And you're going to get the most sublime fusion of two authentic original American spirits, which is going to make your evening a very pleasant one indeed, no matter what the company. I'm Ralphie. There you have it. Yeah, okay, right. You want me to give this a rye, a whiskey and rye mark, don't you? You want me to give this a whiskey and rye mark. Okay, okay. One more swirl, one more smell, one more taste, and then I'll give you that mark. Rittenhouse Bottled and Bond with Eagle Rare 10-year-old, a whiskey and rye, 91 out of 100. A rye, and where's my little bourbon? Where is my bourbon card? Here it is. That's a rye and bourbon mark. See you soon, malt mates. Bye-bye.